we'll do the podcast. Our pretzel loaf is called. Let's see, stations. Let's try ambient. Is it literally people walking through the woods or something for 8 minutes? Because otherwise it might not sound real. I think that's what it is. So, okay, now it's not going to work. But spooky. Nah. Not for this painting. This doesn't feel right. How about lo-fi? Alright, that sounds alright. Hopefully it's more than just this, though. Okay. Now we go back to the camera here. And we're good. Anyway. Better streamer would have picked that out before they came on, but fucking brush should I use on this? Is that right? Oh, before I forget the business stuff, hold on. Silliness that needs to be done first. Yeah, there's times when I think to myself, like, getting old kind of sucks sometimes, but then other times, it's kind of good. Like, you know, they say you have more fun when you're younger and everything like that, but, like, today I got super excited at the fact that I was able to mow my lawn. That sounds boring, but, like, at the same point, like, as a kid, you know, even in your 20s, you never get that excited to mow your lawn. You gotta go out and do something, party. It's like, no, I got that same feeling from mowing my lawn. It's like, we got it done, man. So when people come for the yard sale this weekend, I will say the yard is one of the reasons why I feel the hat's necessary. Last night I mentioned the YouTube channel, Great Art Explained, and yeah, I've really been enjoying it. They've got, I said 20, 19 videos that they have up right now, but yeah, I try to like maybe watch one a day or something. You know, I don't want to flush it out too much, but and obviously once I'm caught up entirely, I guess it'll be once a month or whatever their release schedule is like. Sorry, I'm exhausted from mowing the lawn, though. I had a thought. Oh, but yesterday I had watched, was it yesterday or the day before? I'd watched something about the Mona Lisa. Might have been the day before. I don't remember if I mentioned it or not last night. So, if I mentioned it last night, then it was last night, but if not, it was the day before. But they were, you know, they gave a breakdown of the Mona Lisa and why it's such a good, you know, a good painting, and all the techniques that were done in there, and you know, I think it's one of their first works, actually, when they first did this. But the thing that was funny to me today is that today on Animal Crossings, I logged in there. The fox that sells you artwork was there, and so we bought the Mona Lisa to and it's real, we checked it out. Anybody knows who play Animal Crossing knows you do Hawk's fake shit, but Why does this feel so tight against my head? This is an interesting little moment here, because this is technically, must have been at least two light sources here. Because you definitely have a highlight on this side, but you also have a highlight on this side. I believe this was taken about midday, which means one must be the window, and the other must be the front door. Guess. I remember which way he was laying when I took the picture. He's actually laying on our ottoman, which we the one he was laying on. This one was the one we got from my aunt Nancy when she had passed. I mean, he loves it, especially when there's like one of these like fluffy blankets on it. And I have a great picture of him actually sitting up on it. It was when Andy was still crawling. So you have this little picture of Andy kind of just able to poke his head up above it, like, hey, you know? And Kyurem looking down at him like, oh shit, this little human's mobile. Yeah. My wife said to me the other day, she says, do you mind if I watch Mayor of Easttown? Do you have any interest in watching it? And I said, what do you mean, watch it without me? I said, yeah, that's fine. Yes, that's fine. You know? I mean, I'm always a fan of anything, you know, Philly related or whatever, but it's like, you know, if I get to watch it, I get to watch it, you know. Maybe if it ever slows down at work, I can finally, like, just throw it on the TV downstairs, whatever, working, you know? I haven't been able to watch anything for a long time, so. But, you know, it slows down a little. Maybe I'll give it a try. But what she ends up watching without me last night, Loki. She's like, well, if you didn't stream. What's funniest too to me is like, you know, she doesn't fly in the same circles that I do. She doesn't go to the same websites that I do. And so it's like, she doesn't have to avoid the spoilers. So if she waited a day or two, no big deal. She wasn't gonna have it spoiled for her. But me, on the other hand, because of the, you know, all the comic book nerd sites I go to, it's like, literally, I gotta like look at them like this. set that up, so I can look at the multi stream chat in case. I was, again, I'll go back, because I don't know what to talk about, nobody's talking. So I'll just prattle on what's on my head. The one I watched today of the Great Art Explained was of the two Fridas painting. And now, I was familiar with Frida Kahlo, but I would never followed enough to really know. Like, I was kind of shocked when they said she only made about, 200 paintings or something like that, and that kind of shocked me. I don't know why I thought, like, from the times I've learned about her in art classes and stuff, I just thought there were more. I know she had journals and stuff and drawings and stuff, but I just thought there were more paintings. I don't know why I thought, always concerned about that. I don't know why. I guess it's because I don't have much in the way of attention. I don't want to say followers. It's not followers. I don't really, you know. It's just that right now I can't seem to find galleries. I can't seem to get much attention. But yeah. Here, Instagram, Facebook, whatever, all the places that you need to basically now get attention in order to get galleries and stuff, and you know, I think my concern is always based on, you know, and it's partly due to the fact that, I mean, look, I idolize Van Gogh. He did 800 paintings within his, you know, 10 years of painting. That's a big number to live up to, and I'll never make it. I mean, even if I was painting full time, I don't think I could do 100 paintings a year. Or 80 paintings a year, you know, whatever. Like, I don't think I could ever catch up to that. I mean, when I was going to school, 1 year, I think I, like I said, I think I maybe hit 30. And since then, last year was my most productive, which was 27 paintings. But I'm always thinking about how many total paintings I have, like, and how many I would feel, not that I have any control over, well, unless the depression technically I would have control over if it were to take me, but also not. Because it's a disease, if that works. But, the, you know, not that anyone ever really has full control over when they're going to kick it, but like, my brain basically is foreseeing, sometimes, like, when the depression's, like, at its worst, there's a part of me that just goes, you haven't painted enough yet. And my brain's like, you have to at least do more than Manet. If you can beat Manet, then maybe, you know. Gotham is ashes, and you have my permission to die. Which I don't know, I just don't know where I am as far as number of paintings total completed in my total painting career. I tried to document it once and I had it on a flash drive. I was like pretty sure I had about 80% of them right. There were some I might have forgotten and I was trying to find them all. Because there's some that I did that, like, someone bought or I gave as a gift and I don't remember it. And there's some that, like, I don't know whether I should count as having been completed because I don't know if they exist anymore, to be honest with you. Like, you know, when my ex-wife and I were together, I did a portrait of her. You know, I don't know if she still has it. I don't know if, like, my buddy Drew still has his painting or... pretty sure my buddy Mike and my buddy Bill still have theirs and their portraits. My friend Dawn has hers. But there's some things like that. There's like, that was, you know, that was kind of how I painted my models. It's like, look, if you model for me, you get the painting. Which could be taken as a, you know, a gift or an insult. I don't know, depending on how good the portrait came out, I guess. I still am embarrassed by the Dawn's portrait. I don't think I ever got that one right. That one never came out right. I argued that one. But, so like I said, I when I think about my older stuff, especially the college years, I don't remember how many I did. Up until basically the my wife and I moved in together, I don't know total how many paintings I had back then. I think it was over about 120, 130. I think. And I'm counting really bad ones, too. I'm counting really, really bad ones. Like, stuff that wasn't even remotely in my impressionistic style yet. Like, shit I did in high school. And then there's some that, like, I never finished, that I stripped the canvas of, so those don't count. I don't put those in my total. Because don't ever find them. They're now somewhere in a garbage heap somewhere, you know? they will never be seen. Because even if someone found them, they wouldn't be able to identify them as mine. Plus, 90% of them have been cut up to get them off the canvas, so they'd find fragments at best. But yeah, like I said, I'm just... When I hear, when I heard that she only did, 200 paintings, like, damn, man! Like, my brain tells me, like I said, I say, oh, I gotta beat Manet, but I would really like to, have a portfolio by the time it's time to shake off this mortal coil that's around 400, 450, somewhere in that range. Which, even if you say, let's go on the low side and say I had 100 paintings before my wife and I moved in together. Because once we moved in together, I really couldn't paint. If I were to be at that, then, you know. This year, if I can crack 100, I'd be at 200. But that still means if I want to do 250, I still got 250 to go, which means 10, 15, another 10, 15 years, right? 15 years at the current rate. I mean, look, who knows? Maybe Twitch, maybe YouTube will somehow finally take off enough that I could just do this full time. I don't have bets on it, but you know, I'm just saying, maybe it's a possibility, right? Even if that were to happen, it's like, okay, I'd have to be very careful. I'd have to be really careful about how much I'm doing at this particular time, because if I just let go, I've said this before, I think I was talking to Ftakuba about it a while back. Or maybe it was a little Froggy Boy, I don't remember. Let me put this up on the minute. I didn't put anything on here yet. I haven't done this one because I was trying to rush on here today. Let's go with that. I want to make that visible. Alright, like I said, if I were able to start painting full time, my biggest concern, I've told people before, has been that doubling my time to paint probably means tripling my output. It sounds silly, but it's true. You know, if I were to get back to a point where I could paint, you know, 7-8 hours a day, the legitimate change that occurs is actually much, much higher. trying to this be a little bit more balanced. I'm not sure why. I'm trying to make some work, but not working. I'm trying to think, but nothing happens. Again, saying I could get back to a time period where I would paint, you know, 6, 7, 8 hours a day, as opposed to the 2.5, 3. Anyone that's seen the anyone seen like my 24-hour stream like knows how much stuff I got done in 24 hours, and it's just a matter of painting longer or like the stream I simulcast stream I did with Keto, you know, we painted that painting 13 hours because we were both working, so you know, straight through, we didn't have any distractions really. You don't get cut off, you know, to go give kisses goodnight or whatever, you know, like it's little things like that that can make a big difference sometimes. And for someone like me, it's like, you know, so like I said, if I start painting full time, it just doubling my time, I have to account financially for twice as much shit. Or three times as much shit or whatever to deal with, because I'll probably start painting significantly faster. And that'll be problematic for said, it's weird to think that, like, okay, you know, I make like $53,000 a year, but in order to paint full time, I probably need to make at least $120,000 to make up for the supplies. That would become, you know. know, I'm not begging for money or begging anybody to buy anything. I'm just trying to make it clear, like, you know. Just trying to make a point about production.
doesn't count.
His tail has always interested me. Because the cat's as gray as gray can be, you know. As I said, he picks up a lot of color, which is always interesting, you know. Always becomes a very striking...
The cliche of art is not finished, it's abandoned. Yes, it can always be abandoned. But you have to finish it, you have to put it out, because otherwise you're just the guy talking about your art, you're not the guy doing it. Get better by doing it and finishing it, learning from that process, and moving on to the next thing.
That! I say that all the time. And I mean, especially when it comes to the visual arts. I think with music, it can be a little different. Especially when it falls under something like a classical musician. They're much more about performance than they are specifically the recording element of things, you know. You talk about Yo-Yo Ma or Hilary Hahn or something like that. Like, you're talking about their, like, you know... They're obviously always working on their craft, but every performance is the artwork, so to speak. Like, you know, I mean, yes, they've written their own things, I'm sure, but they're not talking about the written stuff. You know, when it comes to a majority of what they're known for performing other composers' work. So their art is much more, you know, of the technical skills while performing. Whereas for visual artists, especially, like, we are definitely the ones, like, as the last song was saying about the, you know, art isn't finished, it's abandoned. We most certainly abandoned that. I mean, you know, watch this stream enough and you'll hear me tell you quite often how much I dislike a lot of my older works. You know, I can recognize some of them as being... of term more important in my portfolio, you know, like, in other words, like, when it comes to my collection of stuff I've made, it's like, okay, certain paintings have much more gravitas. I may not like them anymore, but I do understand that, okay, this one's kind of important. It's, you know, I mean, the easy one for me to pick out is, like, my tulips that I put up. You know, it's pretty much always my cover photo or whatever in a lot of things. Or, they were the first painting I did after my breakdown. First painting after 4 years or so, you know. No, 3 years, I guess. It was 3 years. Okay, 3 years. I'm looking at the calendar that tells me it's been 3 years. That's probably a really weird scar to keep. I'm gonna switch back to the close-up cam because I wanna see if I can get a shot of it here real quick with the... Oh wait, close-up cam's down. Hold on. Sorry. Before that, I switch it. Let's get that there. Just so I can try to... And I have to turn it off on the secondary window so I can look. Alright. I wanna transition this real quick so anybody can save. The calendar over there is the Preston Steve calendar, Tully Office calendar from 2014. It's the month of May. Truth be told, I don't like that model, Arne Harris. She's attractive, or it certainly was back in 2014. I don't know what she looks like now, but there have been too many times they had her on the show and honestly listened to her talk. It's like, I mean, you know, just awful. It's just awful. And so I'm not a big fan of hers. But the reason she's still here is May 2014 is when I sealed up the studio. That was when I had, you know, my friend Baba died earlier in the year, and I kept trying to work. It wasn't working very well. And by May of 2014, I had had enough. I was in here. I was trying to do another painting. I tried to let go of the painting I had been working on prior to that, and the second painting I had started on, or whatever, was going horribly wrong, and so I cut the canvas up. I may have smashed the stretchers, I'm pretty sure I did. And I sealed the studio up, and outside of, as I've said before, outside of coming out here for some of the storage stuff in the back, you know, I did not touch anything here. You know, I dreaded this room of my house. Anytime the wife asked me to get something, I was like, oh, do we need it? Like, yes, we need the luggage to go on vacation. Fuck. Like, you know, it was like that type of situation. But anyway, it does always remind me exactly. I can always look and see how long it's been since my breakdown. There's no questions. Tells me I'm unstable again. I know this. But how's the stream? They're showing no drop frames, right? I get that I'm unstable. That's fine. But the, chicks dig it. But anyway, like I said, and going back to what I was talking about, which I think on my ADD brain, the way it works. You know, I know those tulips are important. I don't necessarily enjoy them as much as I used to, but I know they're an important piece for me. So, it's like, I have to understand that. If anybody's dropping in, there was a song on here that was some dude doing overdub talking about, you know, how important it is that, you know, everyone has creative elements in them, but, you know, if you're just talking about doing something, you're not doing it, and it doesn't count until you've put something out into the world, you know, until you've, you know, you have a book inside you, you have a song or whatever, you know, that you think you could write, like, until you've done it, it doesn't count. And I'm just going through some, you know. But he talked at one point about the old adage that art is never finished, it's abandoned. I'm just trying to put it in, you know, like, I think that holds true much more for, you know, say, visual artists than I think it does for musicians. My old philosophy teacher in college, he had actually gone to the Curtis Institute of Music, and he had been a oboe player? I want to say an oboe player. That sounds right. But he had long since abandoned it, and he focused much more on just a general study of aesthetics, and his creative side focused a lot into suiseki and bonsai. And he had a number of, like, suiseki pieces that they broke the norm for standard suiseki. He had one piece, it was like stone like this fucking big. It was huge. Got a fish this big. But the die he made, you know, it was gorgeous. It looked like a little mountain range. It was amazing. But usually suiseki is much smaller, if you're not familiar with it. And those who are completely unfamiliar with suiseki, you basically find a rock out in nature. You don't do anything to it. You don't chip it away. You just polish it using the oils from your nose and just rubbing it until it's shiny. But he talked a lot about music, because obviously that was where he had started. And he was not a fan of modern rock or pop music in any way, shape, or form. But he did acknowledge that the artists that made that music, he considered them more performance artists than he did consider them as music writers, composers. A couple guys tried to talk to him about Tool, you know, and how Tool does stuff a little more on a classical mindset, I guess, and how they compose their albums and stuff, but he mostly just said, like, you know, it's because when it comes to rock music and stuff, it's all about the concerts, it's, you know. And it's not entirely wrong, I guess. You know, you think about, or, you know, especially at the time that I went to school, a long time ago, it was a lot about the videos, you know? The video made or break the song, you know? Could make or break the song. I don't think that's as important nowadays. But, you know, it's usually about seeing that artist live at some point. Like, you like the song, but then you go to see them live, and that changes the experience 100%. I know people that have seen a band live and it killed everything they ever felt about the songs that they listened to with the band because, you know, the performers sucked when they were in person. And I'm not talking like Milli Vanilli. I mean, that's a whole other can of worms. But, you know, people that went to see, like, and I don't know, I'm going third hand, you know, this is not third party here, it's not my opinion. I've never seen them live, but, Preston from the Preston Steve Show here in Philly talks a lot about how he dislikes Counting Crows, because when he saw them in concert, they, you know, he felt they kind of half-assed everything. They talked through the lyrics rather than sung them. You know, he said it just left him with a bad taste in his mouth. And maybe it was just an off night, I don't know, you know, but, you know, here was somebody who worked in alternative rock music for his, I can't say his entire career, because he used to be Kenny Knight and playing top 40, but he, you know, he, for the majority of his career, at least, he's been rock and alternative rock, and he got his start here in Philly on, well, actually got a start on WDR80, which was the alternative station for the longest time. And then transitioned to Y100, which was kind of a more popular alternative station, and then went to MMR, which is just everything rock. But, so he's got a place of authority to talk about, you know, the music he's listened to over the years that's come and gone, and you know, like I say, he said he liked Counting Crows when they started, it's just once he saw them live, he, you know, he fell off with it, because he didn't like their performance. So again, that was my philosophy teacher's big thing about music, was he said it was more about performance nowadays than anything else. He didn't give much credit or credence to a lot of newer composers either, like, you know, he didn't like a lot of the avant-garde stuff. He talked about Bernstein, orchestral performances in general, but he was very much of the mindset now that, like, you had to be young to be potent. I don't know if I 100% agree with that, because I'm old. Of course, he was at the time too, so I don't know. And for someone too, that, well, you know, like, I just had a thought in my head, I was gonna go with it, what the hell. No, for someone who's a big fan of Japanese prints, like he was too, he was a big fan of Japanese prints. And Japanese artwork as a whole. You know, it is funny to have him say that, because it's like, Hokusai made a lot of his better works and certainly more well-known works at his older ages, you know, in the 70s and stuff, and he used to say that he thought his old work wasn't even worth the time to look at. Like, this could be me. I'm gonna figure something out when I'm like 65, and I'm like, oh, fuck this! Why did you even look at this shit? Andy, Market Babu. He's like, dude, I'm in my 20s, so I still have to call you Babu? And I'm like, yes! Thank you.
doesn't matter how much you know about implementation or writing layers or any of these kind of video game terms. None of that matters if you can't write music well.
It sounds like the exact same dude, so like this is probably the same type of, you know, it's probably the same vein.
So the first thing for me is always learning your craft. And it doesn't matter where the music is going ultimately. This is when it's in your head and you're still thinking about it. You've gotta know how to basically see it through completion. Practically on your own these days, and have it stand on its own with everything else that's out there.
Feel it, like Marky Mark.
Take those in your head and in your heart and say something meaningful. And I don't think that's necessarily something you learn in school or something you learn from reading a book or watching YouTube videos or anything. I think that's more something you learn from doing it, from trying it over and over and over and over and over.
People are super confused because A, they came in here thinking it's Pokemon, or if they've looked at the reference sketch and they know it's a gray cat. Why is he using so many browns? Thank you. What the hell? Hell. Because I haven't said it yet for a while, or yeah, I haven't said it for a while. I apologize to anyone coming here thinking they were going to look at a painting of a Pokemon. This is my cat. He is named Kyurem. This is my cat. There are many like him, but this one is mine. No, no, no. So it definitely feels like it would be a lot, quote, like, fit the stream a lot more if I was, like, a Frenchman at cafes. I'm not going to get it. Me. mean to do that. I gotta figure out a way to stop this thing from being out, like the pretzel radio or whatever, from being able to post. It didn't do it the first time I used it. I didn't use it very long, I don't think, but I don't remember posting anything in the comment section. It just keeps throwing me off. I keep going, oh, someone's commenting. I immediately do not like this song. Because it keeps using the sound that is the same sound that my alarm clock makes. And that means I'm thinking about work. Let's fuck this song. Seriously, I gotta get off. Nope, next. Alright, that's better. Seriously, I heard the alarm one more time, let's go. Let's just put it this way. I got a real bad temper. Like, one time I lost my temper, and you know those little tags, mattresses? Cut one of them off. This one's not much better. This one has like a... This is repetitive enough. This... It reminds me, like... a couple years ago, I was trying to learn how to program video games and stuff, and I was messing around through Unity. Alright, that was the games. Yeah, Blender was the 3D stuff I was trying to mess with, but Unity was the programming. And I made this stupid little Flappy Bird clone. And I was like, oh man, I just realized it. Like, I released it and I was like, oh, it's silent. It's like, oh, I gotta fix that. So I wrote some stupid little loop. And I mean, it's so short and it's so, like, repetitive. It's so bad. Because I didn't even think about putting audio in it, because I was like, I play my stuff all, with my phone all the way down. Like, I don't ever have sound on my, in a game I'm playing. So 9 times out of 10, I'm playing in a place I'm not supposed to be playing the game, but. I mean, anybody in the stall next to me would be like, hey, what are you doing there? Oh shit, it's 10 o'clock. I'll be right back. Alexa, oh wait, this. Never mind. Wrong fucking thing. Here. Alright. Go back here. Alright. And need that. And I'll be right back. there.
Here.
I was trying to speculate to myself when I thought this would be a finished painting. I think Monday night seems fairly logical, like fairly doable. Are we repeating now? I think this is the part earlier. Or did this use the same sample? What is one that they used yesterday?
You're all
I think I made the joke yesterday. No, I don't. I don't know who the fuck you are. It's been from yesterday. So it's from a different... It's under multiple genres, I guess, or whatever. Because last night I was listening to the piano-based one, so I guess since there's a piano... You can't handle the truth. What the hell does that do? Way of future past. I'm so confused. What the fuck are future pants? Are they like the space pants that Peter Dinklage had on Saturday Night Live? It's such a stupid skit. If you've never seen it, it's so stupid, but it's fucking genius at the same time. Basically, it starts off with, don't ask me the Saturday Night Live people that are on there now, I don't know. But they're starting off basically as if they're going to... It's a mob thing, and they're, you know... There's two informants or whatever, you know, two lackeys that fucked up. And they're going to get whacked. But suddenly, the main act comes on in this club. And it's Peter Dinklage's character, you know, his spot or whatever. Where he's singing about his space pants. And he keeps going off about space pants, you know, whatever. And then, like, they're all like, what the fuck is with space pants? Like, what's with this? And he starts, like, commenting to them, like, while saying, you know, hey, don't be rude to my show. And they're all kind of like, all right, move on. And then suddenly, like, Gwen Stefani comes out and, like, wait, what's Gwen Stefani doing with space pants, boy? And she's got a space skirt, and it's so weird. It's such a bizarre little sketch, but it's so funny. Because by the end of it, you're just like, it's just so confusing. And space pants! I don't even know if I can put part of it up, because it may be something that would fall under copyright under Twitch or YouTube, and they'd give me shit about it or something. It's bad. feel pretty good about tonight, though. They did all right. I mean, look, it's a much smaller painting than the last one. Last one was sizes. I want to say it was 22 by 28. It was something definitely made of inches horizontally and vertically. Some denomination of measurement in those directions. But it was bigger than this one. This one's 16 by 20. This is another one of those ones that I bought it, like, what did I buy? I bought like a 20 pack or 30 pack, something like that. And it was just like, it was dirt cheap, and it was, you know, they're not great canvases or whatever, but the greatest stretch of imagination is going to be great. But, you know, I make them a little better. I put a little extra gesso on them, so this way, paints won't leak through. And it gives them a little more texture, too, so they're not perfectly flat. They're like my safety reserve, though. Like, I think I have five more left after this. Well, no, I take it back. Like, I have seven left. There's two that I've already gessoed, but after that group, there's five still in the box. Putting together some stretcher frames today too, so when I finally get a chance to do the stretching part of it, there will be seven new canvases. Yeah. I think that's one of the things I've been into too much, is I think I've been working too much towards accuracy in my more recent paintings, and I'm like, and not 100%. I mean, I think there's somewhere I feel like I've had a lot more energy, but a number of paintings I've done since I started Twitch, I feel like I worry too much about, does it look like the thing I'm painting, because otherwise people will fucking like look at the reference and be like, oh, fuck that. When 90% of the time, I don't think anyone ever goes into the reference picture. So, why do I give a shit? And it feels straining. So, anyway, that'll be it for now.
If it's an accident, the error that feels good, then we'll leave it in.
Alright, get rid of that. Put that there. So tomorrow, next stream will be Sunday at 7:30. As I said, I don't know if I'm going to have time to come in here tomorrow. I may want to try to stream just a game. I wouldn't be doing painting. Just be something to mess around with. I don't know. I'll figure that out. If I do it, I do it. If I don't, I don't. Such is the world. So everybody have a good night, and hopefully see you on Sunday.